Hello everyone, welcome to this video on the Parajumbles concept brought to you by Learning Made Easy team, a team of IIM grads in association with their e-learning partner GTCUBE Get to the Top. If you are watching this video in the YouTube channel, make sure that you check out our full-length courses available for free at gtcube.com/store. We'll get to watch these videos as part of the courses and also get to practice a lot of questions on these concepts, which would help you understand this concept better. So, in this video, we're going to talk about different types of questions based on Parajumbles. We will give you some tips and tricks briefly while we solve some questions in this. You will find other courses or rather other videos on Parajumbles where we have done a detailed explanation of different techniques that can be used to solve Parajumbles. So you can check them, you know, at www.gtcube.com/store. So do check them out. So let's get started. So Parajumbles, one of the type is, you know, four lines based thing. So what is meaning of Parajumbles, right? So it's basically like this. I give you four sentences or five sentences, whatever the number of sentences be. Properly sequenced, right? You won't see the proper sequence. That is, it doesn't mean that A, B, C, D makes a meaningful paragraph. I don't know the correct sequence. I need to identify the sequence in which, if I arrange, I can make it a meaningful paragraph, right? That is, whatever the sequence be, and these are the options you will see, right? So A, B, C, D is one potential sequence. A, D, C, B is another. D, B, C, A, D, B, A, C. All you need to do is to find out what is that meaningful sequence, which if I arrange would make a meaningful paragraph, right? The logical order of sentences, which would make a coherent paragraph. That's the entire objective of this Parajumbles questions. So what you need to do is read the state sentences and try to pick some clues which would help you to actually get some pairs. Okay, this is a useful technique that will work for most of the cases. Unless if you have a question where you don't have options, you need to enter, type in the answer. That's a bit painful and a difficult question to attempt for sure in Parajumbles. But generally, if you have options, identifying a couple of pairs or maybe even one pair should actually give you the right answer. Right? So let's get started with this example. So the likelihood of an accident is determined by how carefully the motorist drives and how carefully the pedestrian crosses the street. Right, so this is like talking about something, accident, likelihood about motorist and pedestrian, how careful they are. An accident involving a motorist and a pedestrian is such a case. Right, this one is such a case. So what are they referring to, right? That's something that I need to understand. So it's saying an accident involving a motorist and a pedestrian is such a case. What do they mean by is such a case? They've given some concept. Then they're saying that an accident involving a motorist and a pedestrian is such a case. Let's read a third statement. Each must decide. What do we mean by each, right? Whom are we referring to? Each must decide how much care to exercise without knowing how careful the other is. You know, words like this are the clues for you, which you can see other sentences answering those questions based on which you can understand the sequence. The simplest strategic problem arises when two individuals interact with each other and each must decide what to do without knowing what the other is doing. This looks like a very generic statement with no, questionable words in it. Like what I mean by that is, what I mean by each, what do I mean by such a case, other, etc. Right? The simplest strategic problem arises when two individuals interact with each other and each must decide what to do without knowing what the other is doing. This and B seems like a link because an accident involving a motorist and a pedestrian is referring to this part. That the simplest strategic problem. So I am telling a point or an opinion. Our author is giving an opinion that the simplest strategic problem arises when there are two individuals interacting with each other and each must decide what to do without knowing what the other is doing. Then an accident involving a motorist and pedestrian is such a case. Right, I'm saying one of the examples for this opinion or statement is accident involving pedestrian and a motorist. So D and B make a meaningful pair for me. So first I should see D and then I should see B. Right, so see, I'll straight away eliminate this because I see B and then D. Here I have D then B, but they're still not a pair. I'll just keep it aside for now. DB and DB, so I see pairs, right? So I will mostly eliminate this, but you know, there are still two options because I am eliminating this because I'm not seeing DB as a pair, right? So these two are those two options which are both DB. So the problem is as simple as it. So I need to understand, is it DBCA or is it DBAC? What should be a meaningful line after B? Right? And what should be the sentence? Is it CA or AC? So let's read this in this sequence, right? DBCA. The simplest strategic problem arises when two individuals interact with each other and each must decide what to do without knowing what the other is doing. An accident involving a motorist and a pedestrian is such a case. Right? Now I have linked both D and B. Then what am I saying? Each must decide how much care to exercise without knowing how careful the other is. Here each and other are clear for us after we read D and B, right? It's basically talking about a motorist and a pedestrian. So an accident involving a motorist and a pedestrian is such a case. Each must decide how much care to exercise without knowing how careful the other is. And then the likelihood of an accident is determined by how carefully the motorist drives and how carefully the pedestrian crosses the street. This is looking like a bit, you know, incomplete or haphazardous for me. Let's look at DBAC. The simplest strategic problem arises when two individuals interact with each other and each must decide what to do without knowing what the other is doing. An accident is involving a motorist and a pedestrian is such a case. The likelihood of an accident is determined by how carefully the motorist drives and how carefully the pedestrian crosses the street. Each must decide how much care to exercise without knowing how careful the other is. This looks like a better read for me than this. It's very minute to, you know, distinguish. To be frank, I would go with DBAC for the reason only that after saying that an accident involving a motorist and a pedestrian is such a case, then this one is again going a bit generic, saying that the likelihood of an accident is determined by how carefully the motorist drives and how carefully the pedestrian crosses the street. Then each must decide how much care to exercise without knowing how careful the other is. Right? Reading AC is more, you know, meaningful than CA. Outright, I would not say CA is bad. If I don't see this option, I see some other sequence, I would have definitely agreed with this. But, you know, with this sequence, I would go with DBAC. Right? Now, the other type is with five lines, right? Similar, exactly this concept is same, is just that it adds a bit more complexity because we have five lines to look at. Both parties use capital and labor in the struggle to secure property, right? So what do we mean by both properties, right? Both parties. What are these both parties? The thief spends time, I think this is sort of a hint for this, but let's read. Thief spends time and money in his attempt to steal. He buys wire cutters. And the legitimate property owner expends resources to prevent the theft. So the legitimate property owner. So these are the two property parties, I guess, which is referred in the first statement. A social cost of theft is that both the thief and the potential victim use resources to gain or maintain control over property. Right? This also is talking about, you know, the social cost of theft, thief and potential victim using, you know, resources to gain or maintain control over the property. So what I feel is this, right? This I say, the general one of the useful trick is this. Generally in the paragraph structure, you generally start off with a generic statement or a general view, right? And then go with a specific point that you want to answer, you know, or you want to talk about or tackle. For example, look at this example. This entire paragraph started off with a very generic statement about a simple strategic problem when two individuals are, you know, interact and then decide what to do. Then the next three statements will talk about a specific view about an accident is such an example for the first generic statement. That's a very specific statement talking about only accident. Then the other two statements A and C are also talking only about the accident. So that's a generic, you know, flow of a paragraph, normal flow of a paragraph. So again, I see something similar here. It says the social cost of theft is that both the thief and the potential victim use resources to gain or maintain control over the property. So this is not exactly a general statement, but then I would say this looks like a start for me, like giving you a gist or what I'm trying to talk about or what the author is trying to talk about in this paragraph. A social cost of the theft is that both the thief and the potential victim use resources to gain or maintain control over the property. Right, then both parties use capital and labor in the struggle to secure property rights. So I would say CA, because this one is talking about the social cost of the theft. And then it's now continuing with both parties use capital and labor in struggle to secure property rights. And then it further explains in statement B, saying, what do I mean by that? What does the author mean by saying both parties use capital and labor in struggle to secure property rights? The thief spends money to steal and the property owner spends money to prevent the theft, right? That's by buying the lockers and buying the wire cutter. So CAB makes a very meaningful flow for me. What I can definitely say is A is not the right statement to start off with. I can cut off this and this. Why? Because both parties is something which I don't have an answer if I start off with A. Here I find the answer about the thief and the potential victim. So both the options are straight away cut. Then I see CAB here. I see CBEDA, right? Which obviously does not make much sense for me. I can, you know, go ahead and mark this. That's what I said. I didn't even read D and E. But I still can mark it just because I can make some sense from couple of pairs, right? Just finding one to two pairs would actually help us to get the correct answer by eliminating the wrong options. So let's read this. So I'm saying a social cost of theft is that both thief and victim use resources to gain or maintain control over property. Both parties use capital and labor in the struggle to secure property rights. The thief spends time and money in his attempt to steal, and the legitimate property owner expends resources to prevent the theft. These costs, right? What are we referring to these? These costs are basically this, you know, the money spent, time spent on, you know, the thief trying to steal and the property owner trying to prevent the theft. So this is answered by it. So D cannot be in the earlier phase, right? It should be after I see CAB, you know, or basically after B, to be very frank. These costs may escalate as a type of technological arms race unfolds. Then a bank may purchase more and more complicated and sophisticated safes, forcing safecrackers to invest further in safecracking equipment. This again, like DE is one pair that I can see. Why? So the D says these costs, so this is answered, I would say, in B, money spent to steal and prevent the theft, may escalate as some new technology, you know, unfolds. And then it continues to talk about that in E, saying that a bank may purchase more and more. You know, this is like a bit generic statement saying that the cost will go up with some new technology coming in. And then the author is giving an example saying a bank may purchase, for example, a bank may purchase more and more complicated and sophisticated safes, forcing safe crackers to invest further in safe cracking equipment. And as I said, some statement is given and then an example to further elaborate the statement is also a standard pair that we see. So statement should come first and then the example, right? That is a meaningful flow as well. That would also help us to identify the. So DE is one pair, CAB is like another pair. So CABD, I can identify. That's why the answer is option 2. Now, this is third type where you see parajumbles. So technically they look like 6 lines. The advantage is that they actually fix the first and the last line. So that is fixed. I just need to find the order for the remaining 4 lines in between it. So that is making it a bit easy for us because basically, you know, the first, so you can find the connection after the first statement and also find something relevant to 6 so that I can find at least, you know, some clues in the first and the last, rather than the earlier questions where we had to decide which one would be the first or, you know, second and the last line, etc. So commercially reared chicken can be unusually aggressive and are often kept in darkened sheds to prevent them pecking at each other. You know, this is like them pecking at each other. The birds spent far more of their time, up to third, pecking at the inanimate objects in the pens, in contrast to birds in other pens which spent a lot of time attacking others. Okay, this is some statement. In low light conditions, they behave less belligerently but are more prone to ophthalmic disorders and respiratory problems. Again, okay. Talking about low light conditions, which is sort of relevant to this darkened sheds. In an experiment, aggressive head pecking was all but eliminated among birds in the enriched environment. Right. So this sounds like something I need to, you know, look at. And some experiment was done and aggressive head pecking was all but eliminated among birds in the enriched environment. This seems to have some link with this because the birds spent far more of their time up to third pecking at inanimate objects in the pens in contrast to birds in other pens which spent a lot of time attacking others. This looks like some experiment on in which, you know, the result is something like this. The observation is that the birds spent, some birds are kept in a, some particular experimental setup and then some other are kept In normal, that's why they are attacking others, and then some birds are pecking the inanimate objects. So I would say C and A, but let's read and I'll come to that. Altering the bird's environment by adding bales of wood shavings to their pens can work wonders. So I don't know what this bales of wood shavings is. Something, okay, let's understand that the bird's environment can be altered, changed by adding something to their pens, and that can work wonders. That's what this statement is saying. And then the sixth statement says bales could diminish aggressiveness and reduce injuries. They might even improve productivity, since a happy chicken is a productive chicken. So it's again talking about the bales could diminish aggressiveness and reduce injuries. So whatever this bales of wood shavings is, so that thing can actually reduce injuries and make a productive chicken, that's basically happy chicken, etc. So what I'll start off with this is this. I see C and A seem to be a meaningful logic for me. Why? So as I said, this is talking about some experiment. Aggressive head picking was all but eliminated among the birds in the enriched environment, and the birds spent far more of their time up to pick, you know, third, picking at inanimate objects, in contrast to birds in other pens which spent a lot of time attacking others. So this looks like a pair for me. And another thing is this, commercially reared chicken can be unusually aggressive and are often kept in darkened sheds to prevent them picking at each other. In low light conditions, they behave less belligerently but are more prone to ophthalmic and respiratory problems. Again, looks like a connection after one. So the first statement is talking about how they are, you know, aggressive, and how low light conditions would make them behave belligerently. That's why they are more prone to more prone to ophthalmic disorders and respiratory problems, right? So I feel like 1 and B makes a pair and CA makes a pair. CA is a pair here, but 1 is not starting off with B, so I would not mark this. Obviously, there's only one option actually I see, which is starting from B, and also I see the pair CA, right? CA is anyways not a pair here, CA is not a pair here. So CA is a pair here, but the issue is that it is coming like the B is coming at the end and D is coming at the first. So for me, this seems to be the correct option, because I see 1B, DCA2 is the sequence. So I see this pair and I see CA. These are the two pairs I identified. So commercially reared chicken can be usually aggressive when they are kept in darkened sheds to prevent them from picking at each other. In low light conditions, they behave less belligerently, right? Which is, you know, making sense to have it in continuation, because this is talking about the same thing. Darkened sheds is basically low light. And in low light conditions, they behave less belligerently but are more prone to ophthalmic disorders and respiratory problems. Then again, you will see CA as a pair, because it's talking about some experiment and the observation of the experiment seems to be the birds spending far more time pecking at inanimate objects in the pens, in contrast to birds in other pens which spent a lot of time attacking others. Right? So that sort of CA is things. So that's why BDCA is a meaningful sequence for me. Another type is this, where you have to find the odd statement out from the given statements. That is, like, I give you 5 sentences related to topic. 4 of them can be put together to form a meaningful statement, a paragraph, but one of them would not fit into that paragraph. Right? So I have 5. I don't need to figure out the sequence. All I need to figure out is the one statement which is not fitting in this entire context. The objective is, you know, grouping 4 of them into one, talking about one key point, or one key message, or the same point. There'll be one statement which is not fitting into this. You know, the complexity is added by giving very similar to what you see. very similar to these 4 statements, but there'll be some irrelevant stuff it is talking, but it looks like relevant with respect to just the absolute words. Right? So let me show this, right? So here, see, people who study children's language spend a lot of time watching how babies react to the speech they hear around them. So some people who ever study children's language spend a lot of time watching how babies react to the speech they hear around them. Right? When the kids hear some voice, some words, how do they react to it is what these people observe. A lot of time is spent on that part. Right? They make films of adults and babies interacting and examine them very carefully to see whether the babies show any signs of understanding what the adults say. So it's basically saying they record some films where kids and adults talk, and they carefully observe and see if babies actually show any signs of understanding. Again, this looks like a bit relevant to what 1 and 2 are talking. Let's look at the third. They believe that babies begin to react to the language from the very moment they are born. So it's again talking about the babies reacting to the language from the moment they were born. So, okay. Sometimes the signs are very subtle. Slight movements of the baby's eyes or the head or the hands. It's talking about the movement, how, you know, the reaction of the kids, right? Explaining the reaction of the kids a bit more. So sometimes the signs are very subtle, the slight movements of the baby's eyes or head or the hands. You would never notice them if you were sitting just with the child, but by watching a recording over and over, you can spot them. So this is again talking about watching a recording over and over, and you can spot them. You know, for me, if you see, the major point is this, right? Basically watching kids, that babies, and their reaction to see, their language, comprehension or language understanding ability, comprehension ability, whatever it is. That's sort of the key message that are the area that the author is trying to talk in this paragraph. So people who study children's language spend a lot of time watching how babies react to speech around them. They make films of adults and babies interacting and examine them very carefully to see whether the babies show any signs of understanding what the adults say. This again sort of agrees to this statement, right? So they spend a lot of time. So how do they spend? They record, right? They make films of adults and babies interacting. Sometimes the signs are very subtle, slight movement of the baby's eyes or the head or the hand. So they're talking about, again, the signs of, baby's reaction. They believe that babies begin to react to the language from the very moment they are born. This one looks like the odd one for me in this, because here it's not talking about understanding, watching, the reactions of the baby or trying to understand the baby's reaction, how you record them or how you watch them or anything on that sense. See, the rest of the 4 points, you would never notice them if you're just sitting with the child, but by watching a recording over and over, you can spot them. This is again talking about watching how babies react, right? They're saying they're very subtle signs, so basically you have to watch them again and again. So for me, 1, 2, 4, 5 make a meaningful, group. I'm not saying the sequence is so. Maybe if I try to look at it as a sequence, people who study children's language spend a lot of time watching could be the first statement, because that's like a good start. So these people, there are some people who spend a lot of time watching how they react. They make is basically these people who watch. So I would say this also looks like a good combination. Then I would say sometimes the signs are very subtle. Slight movements of the baby's eyes or the head or the hands. That's why maybe 4 and 5 looks like a pair for me, because the signs are very subtle. That's why you would never notice them if you're just sitting with the child, but by watching a recording over and over, you can spot them. Maybe 1, 2, 4, 5 is a meaningful pair or a sequence for me. Maybe 1, 2, 5, 4 could also be a decent thing. But I think this looks a bit better. But anyways, as whatever it is, that doesn't matter. For me, it's very clear. 3 does not fit in this. Because 3 is like still talking about babies react to the language. But then here the key message or the key that the author is talking about is people observing, trying to understand how babies react, watch them, record them, etc., etc. So this statement, they believe that babies begin to react to the language from the moment they are born, is like a bit odd in this setup, right? It will not come in any flow over here. So that's why I would select the option 3 is the odd one in this entire 5 options, right? That's how you should mark them. You don't need to find out the proper sequence, but rather try to select those 4 statements which are talking about a similar key area. Right, on a superficial level, even the 3rd statement looks like talking the same thing, right? Babies react to language, etc. But then if you just deep dive and understand what is the key thing that the author is talking about, it's not just about babies reacting, it's about recording, understanding how subtle the signs would be, and etc., etc. So which is not something that's the 3rd statement agreeing to, or rather focusing on. It's talking about slightly different things, so I'll mark 3rd statement. So thank you for watching this video. If you're watching this video in the YouTube channel, make sure that you check out our full length courses available for free at gtcube.com/store. We'll get to watch these videos as part of the course and also get to practice a lot of questions on these concepts. Also like our partner's Facebook page, facebook.com/gtcube3. We're coming up with a lot of content that would help you in your preparation. If you follow this page, you will get all the updates and notifications. So don't miss that. Thank you, and let's meet in the next video.